Hi, second graders. Welcome back to Mrs. Nobby's virtual science lab in my backyard. It's good to be back with you today. Remember last time we started the life cycle of plants. We talked about seeds and germination. We put together seed baggies. I planted some seeds for you. We took a trip inside of a bean seed to see the baby plant ready to come out. And we read The Seasons of Arnold's Apple Tree so that we could see an apple tree go through different seasons in its life cycle. Thank you to those of you that sent pictures of your little greenhouses, the seeds you sprouted in bags. A lot of you did popcorn, which is awesome. My popcorn didn't actually grow, but I wanted to show you my bean. So I did open up my seed baggie so that you could see. I want to make sure you know which came out first, the root or the shoot. Now the root should have come out first and gone down, and the shoot goes up. In the case of the bean, you can still see the seed coat from the bean, and you can see where the cotyledons were. That's the actual seed that gave the plant energy before these true leaves could come out and actually use the sun, air, and water to make its own food for the plant. Now we're also going to do a close-up in a minute on some root hairs. Let me switch these out. And you can see the pumpkin. So roots come out first, and this is all part of the process of germination, which means the seed is starting to grow. The roots came down, they have root hairs that actually absorb the water. Without the hairs, they couldn't absorb any water. You can still see the seed coat of the pumpkin, and you can see where the shoot came out. Now I want to show you this pumpkin plant up close. So I started out hanging it just like you did. This was right side up. So the root went down and the shoot came up. But then I decided to try turning the bag. And look what happened to the root. The root still went down and the shoot went up. They have a chemical known as a hormone in them to tell them which way to go. That way the root always finds the soil and the leaves in the shoot always find the sun. Speaking of finding the sun, I wanted to show you these pumpkin sprouts. Now I put seeds in this soil and the window was on this side of the sprouts. I found that the pumpkin seeds grew toward the light. The other day I turned it so that the window was still here and the seeds were going this way, the sprouts moved towards the light. We talk about plants being alive, and one way we know is that they move. We don't get to see it very often, but they definitely will follow the sunlight. The plants that we have sprouted have gotten to the leaf stage in their life cycle. We started by adding water and giving them warmth and air, and they germinated, which means to start to sprout. Now they have stems and roots and leaves. Now we're going to start looking for flowers and talk about pollination and seeds. And so we're going to take a trip to Addison. We're going to do something called Walk of Stages or Life Cycle Bingo. If you haven't already downloaded and printed out your sheet, you can do that and follow along with me. So Life Cycle Bingo and flowers and pollinators. So I'll see you at the Addison grounds on our walk. As I was getting in my car to go to Addison, I discovered that this flower had opened. This is an amaryllis in my driveway, and it's perfect to be able to see the flower parts. So in the middle is what's called the pistil. It's sticky so that it can accept pollen. All around it are the stamen, that's the male part of the flower, and that makes the pollen. You can take a paintbrush and move the pollen from the stamen to the pistil, and that would pollinate the flower. And it looks like it may have already been pollinated because we can see a seed start to form behind the flower. Now this is called self-pollination. Many flowers can do that. Some plants have to pollinate from flower to flower on the same plant, and some have to pollinate from one plant to another plant. Before we start our walk to find plants in different stages, I wanted to show you how you can make a pollen collector. I took some cardstock and I punched some holes, about 5 holes in it. I'm gonna put some tape on the back covering each hole. And when I visit flowers, I can get a little bit of pollen on the sticky tape to take with me. Now pollen comes in all shapes and colors, and it's essential for a plant to be able to make seeds. on our walk, we're going to see if we can get bingo by finding a seed, a seedling, a mature plant, a flower, and a fruit. Now, I'm going to give myself also a sticker every time I find a pollinator. Maybe a bee or a butterfly or an ant or even the wind can be a pollinator. It was hard not to stop at these bright red flowers as I passed by. What a great example of a flower on our life cycle bingo. Now I'm actually going to turn my page over to the second page and also count this flower as a flower for a that stands straight up for a visitor to land on top. Bees could easily land here, drink the nectar, scoop up some pollen to take back to the baby bees. This is the giant oak tree by your playground in the back of Addison. We consider this a mature plant. It's grown tall, it makes flowers in the spring, and acorns in the fall, which is a seed. A mature plant is one that can go through the whole life cycle from seed to seed. I found a great example of a flower that a butterfly would love. The flowers are in clusters, so a butterfly can sit and put its proboscis, its long tongue, down in each one without having to fly from flower to flower, thus saving energy. I wanted to show you the bird feeder that I put here a couple weeks ago when I was showing you how to make a bird feeder. I hung it here covered with seed, and look at it now. The birds definitely enjoyed it. Look what I found in this Walston strawberry patch, a juicy red ripe strawberry. This is a great example of a fruit, and you can see on this fruit, the seeds are found on the outside of the fruit instead of the inside. I'm here at the wisteria vine, and I've seen all kinds of pollinators, mostly bees, but I've also seen some ants and insects that are crawling down into the tubes that are created by the wisteria flower. Now, flowers are shaped the way they are to be able to attract pollinators. Some pollinators like to land, some like to hover, some like to crawl down in the tubes, and some, like butterflies, have long tongues to stick down into those tubes to drink the nectar for energy. I'm here beside the front entrance of school by the large magnolia tree. Now, this time of year, it's harder to find seeds. That's more in the fall when we find seeds. But I know that this magnolia pod used to have seeds inside of it. And this is the housing that carried those seeds. I'm collecting some pollen from the iris flower. And you can see all the yellow pollen and the sticky pistil right there. When a bee goes inside this plant, it collects pollen sort of by accident on its fuzzy legs and goes to another iris plant and leaves some there, thus pollinating the flower. I'm collecting pollen from a poppy, which has landing strips. You can see the lines that lead the bees into the area where the pollen is. I'm here at the pear tree in the bus island, and I was so excited to find that it's covered with pears. Pollinators, such as bees, have been hard at work. You can see all of the baby pears growing on this tree. And I looked down, one of the seeds from last year that was found inside the pear has sprouted into a seedling. This is our seedling of the pear tree. A seedling is a small plant that has just sprouted. It has leaves already, but it does not have a flower and can't make seeds yet. These are plants I was hoping not to find in Addison. These are definitely weeds, which is just a plant that grows where you don't want it to grow, but they are full of seeds. These seeds have a special way of dispersing, which means moving. They can fly in the wind. They have little parachutes that help them get to where they want to go. Now, seeds don't really want to go to a certain place. They can't think, but they need to go to where they can get air, water, and sun away from the parent plant, which is shady, and then they can sprout into a new plant, which brings me to my stem challenge that I'm going to tell you about next. At Addison, we saw an example of a seed that looked like a tiny parachute that could fly on the wind. The seed was at the bottom of the parachute, and the little hairs allowed it to fly. Many seeds can be dispersed, which means moved from one place to the other, not by the actual seed, but by what they have around the seed. Another type of seed that can fly on the wind are the helicopters, which are seeds from the maple tree. This one isn't dry yet, so it's not going to fly, but this one is old from last year, and if I throw it up, it'll twirl on the way down. That way it goes far away from the parent plant, which is, provides too much shade for it to grow. Seeds are amazing. Based on their design, some can float, like the coconut seed. Some can fly, like the maple seed we just saw. Some, like cockleburrs, can stick to people's clothes and to the fur of animals, thus being carried a greater distance. So I've designed a STEM challenge for you to take a seed, such as a lima bean or any seed that you can find, and modify it or change it, add something onto it, so that it can do one of the following. Float for 1 minute, even in waves, while it stays dry. Or be carried by an animal. You can use a stuffed animal or maybe even your dog for this. Be carried as the animal hops. It can't fall off for 3 meters. And the other test, if you want to design a seed that can be flung and fly in the wind, it needs to be able to go 2 meters without dropping. If you do choose to do the STEM challenge today or this week, please send me a picture or video of your results at julie.nobby@cobbk12.org. Now, I said I had a surprise for you at the end of the video. I have 24 eggs in an incubator to be hatched for second grade. So I put them in a week ago. I'm getting ready to candle them with this bright light, which will show me if there's a chicken developing inside. My next video, I'll tell you how many chickens we have developing, and they may even be hatched by then. Bye, second graders. I hope you enjoyed this video. I sure miss you. See you next time.